Hi, I'm Jenny Brocchi. Tonight on Insight, making decisions with everything on the line. Was the decision made with your head or with your heart?
I do everything by my heart.
Pilots are always taught to evaluate the decisions and if it's not getting the right result, to change it. It helps no one if you follow every rule and you don't survive.
What was the worst case scenario that you had?
Death. No, I'll never know, but I made the right decision.
Welcome, everybody. Good to have you with us tonight. Dan, you own a small supermarket in Queensland. Earlier this year, two men tried to rob your store. Let's have a look at how you reacted. What are you doing there?
Just trying to get them to leave, basically, in a hurry.
What were you using? What?
A can of Mortein and a cigarette lighter.
And what made you do that?
2 or 3 days prior to that, I was spraying some wasp nests. And if you hit them with the flame, they go straight away.
A bit dangerous.
Probably. Mm. Probably.
Do you remember what went through your mind when they first came in? Because they had guns.
Yeah. About 8 years prior to that, I had another store in another part of Brisbane, and I had someone come in with a knife that morning. Now, they got right up into my face before my mind registered what was wrong here. They had a balaclava on and they got right in up into my face with a knife at me. Luckily at the time I happened to be cutting a pumpkin with a slightly bigger knife and we had words. I threw my coffee cup at him and I chased him out the door. But ultimately I think it was some kind of training mechanism kicked in. It happened once and I was never going to let someone do that again. Mm. And I recognised them straight away for what they were doing.
Did you weigh up the risks at all of doing what you did, given that they did have guns?
No.
Not at all.
No, I think if I had time to weigh up the risks, I probably wouldn't have done it.
Mm. And what happened after you did it?
If you watch the footage, one of them falls over and the gun falls out of his bag. And I think he looks up and thinks, well, this isn't going the way we planned. He hands the gun to his mate and they come around at me from either side then. And that's when I realised that they weren't going anywhere. I couldn't get an angle on both of them with what I was doing, so I just had to put the can of Mortein and the cigarette lighter down, and that was probably when I was actually fearful the most, because I thought to myself, when I'm crouched down there, the first thing that went through my mind there is these guys aren't going to be real happy with me.
Yeah, and presumably they weren't.
And when I was sitting there like that, I thought, I'm going to get my head cracked open this morning. They're going to get what they want, and they're going to give me a crack in the back of the head.
If you'd had other customers in the store, do you think you would have made that decision to pick up the can and use the flames?
I don't think I would have. I don't think I would have. I've been in another scenario once before where I was in a bank robbery in Brisbane. I was doing some banking and
You've had more than your fair share stuff.
Yeah, trouble knows where I am all the time.
Sorry, I interrupted you.
That's right. So I was doing the banking, but I actually had the money on the counter at the Westpac branch that I was robbed in when the guy came in. And I grabbed the money and laid down on it, hoping he wouldn't see it. And he came over to me, teller, and then he wanted to stand on me and look over into the teller's drawer. So he gave me a few swift kicks in the ribs to get me to move over. And while he was standing on me, I had my head down, and I can remember thinking to myself, if I roll out here, he's going to fall. There's enough of us in here to jump on him. That second, as I was thinking that, a shell casing fell down that he put a shot into the roof. And then I looked up across at a lady who was in a fetal position on the floor, crying her eyes out. And the next thing I thought of, if I do that and he falls and accidentally shoots her, where does that leave me?
Mm.
So I think I've had some experience in those situations where I can sort of, you know, if people are around, I won't do crazy things like that.
Do you think it's a crazy thing now that you did?
Yes, but who's to say if I had just crouched down, done exactly what they said, I wouldn't have got a smack in the back of the head for my trouble anyway, so that, you know, give them more time to get away. There's so many variables that could have, would have, should have happened.
Mm.
But it turned out well. I got out. No one got hurt.
Lauren, 2 years ago, you made a split-second decision to rescue two little boys from drowning. Where were you and what were the conditions like in the water?
We're at Coffs Creek in Coffs Harbour. My husband, my two-year-old son and I. It was a nice day. There were like people everywhere, but it was a king tide. And there were two little boys swimming just past the break wall, and I didn't see them in trouble until their mum on the side started screaming, "Somebody help my boys."
How far away were they from you?
Probably about 6-7 metres. Mm-hmm. So I was just waist deep. I was 8.5 months pregnant.
Did you think about the risk to you and the baby when you jumped in the water to save those little boys?
I don't think I did. I could see the boys were climbing up each other and they were both under the water, so I just...
They were pushing one another under the
water. They were pulling each other down, trying to get up, yeah.
Mm. Did you have a plan?
No, because when I got to the boys, I went under as well. So if I had a plan, yeah, I might have thought, how do you tread water with two boys under your arms?
When you're 8.5 months pregnant.
Yeah. But no, I didn't. So once I got there, we all went under and someone jumped in and saved all three of us, which is where everything... Yeah, that's
what
the hero.
What did you think afterwards about what you'd done? Was it instinct, what you did,
I think,
do you
so.
Think?
Mm. Yeah. So I think deep down I knew I was a strong swimmer, that I'm confident.
And afterwards,
what do you do if you see someone drowning? Like, yeah. Mm.
And afterwards, what did you think?
I was in shock for a while. I knew it was important. Like, the mum was so appreciative and...
I bet she was.
..hugged me, yeah, and the man that saved me was amazing. His family were so proud of everyone, like of him and me. But I think it was the reaction of the public after that made me realise what I'd done.
So you didn't really think that much about it?
No. No. Mm.
Richard, on the 4th of November 2010, you were the captain of flight QF32 from Singapore to Sydney. You had 469 people on board. 4 minutes after takeoff, what did you hear?
There were two explosions, which is not normal, and it sounded like a backfire in a car. So it could be one engine backfiring or surging or failing, or it could have been two engines having trouble, but I didn't really know which one it was, but it didn't really matter anyway. We're trained when things go wrong, we're trained to pretty well instinctively go into our procedures to fly the aeroplane, keep it flying, and then we have a structure for recovering and landing.
What did you do? Did you have a moment of emotional response? Did you have a moment of fear? Was anything like that in the picture?
There wasn't really time for emotion. I didn't actually have emotion till about 6 hours later after the event. So what happens is we are trained in simulators to when these things go wrong, it brings in an almost instinctive reaction to protect the aeroplane. So we practice this and these become habits and instincts. So we do the drill, we stabilise the aeroplane, we call that aviate, and then we navigate, so we build up a plan and keep away from the mountains. And then we communicate, we tell the passengers what's wrong and we recover the aeroplane. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of money spent in aviation to skill the pilots so that when things go wrong, they tend to not panic and they keep calm and follow a logical and slow process to guarantee coming home.
Mm. Claire, you were on that plane and you had a clear view of the damage. How did you react when you heard the two explosions and what did you see?
Well, I immediately looked out the window. I saw a huge amount of fuel flying out from behind the wing, initially some sparks, so...
What was that like?
I just knew that this wasn't right.
Now, Richard, one of the other pilots made an announcement. Let's listen to that.
I do apologise. I'm sure you are aware we have a technical issue with our number two engine. We have dealt with the situation at the moment. The aircraft is secure at this stage. We're going to have to hold for some time whilst we do lighten our load by dumping some fuel and a number of checklists we have to perform. But as you can, I'm sure you are aware, we're not proceeding to Sydney at this stage. We're making our left turn now to track back towards Singapore. And as we progress with this, we'll keep you informed. At this stage, everything is secure. The aircraft is flying safely. And we'll get back to you very shortly with further information. Thank you for your patience.
So calm. Claire, how did you react when you heard that?
Well, that was good because I was looking out the window thinking, this is not good. At one point, when a piece of wing flew across the top, when they did the first turn, a piece of wing flew across the top of the wing. I asked the girl in front of me, who was also, her face was pinned to the glass, and said, did you see that? And she said, yes, I'm going to say it was a bird. And I thought, this isn't helpful.
Meanwhile, Richard, what's going on in the cockpit? What had you worked out had happened?
Well, we actually didn't really know what had happened. We did about 100 checklists in the air.
And there was noise in the cockpit. Let's have a listen. While you're prioritising, I just want people to hear what you're hearing in the cockpit. Okay, so this is going on while you're trying
to prioritise. That's an attention getter to say something's wrong.
How were you making decisions, though, during that time about, you know, what had happened, what to do?
It didn't matter what had happened. That's behind us. Pilots don't look at what's happened. We just focus on what's ahead. So we had an engine that was damaged and fuel systems. Out of 22 systems on the airplane, 21 were affected. So we had to try and fix the things that were broken, work out what we had left, and then work out how we were going to land it.
Were you scared during that time? You were trying to work out what to do next?
There wasn't time to be scared. I never reflected back on the flight. I never stopped to take account of where we were. Pilots are always fighting the enemy in front. So we've got checklists, we've got things to do. So I never thought about where we were overall, or I never thought about my wife and family, because we're there to do a job, and that job's to save the passengers, and that's occupies all of our thoughts. Mm. We were airborne for about 1 hour and 50 minutes, and then there was another 2 hours on the ground. So it was a spectacular event.
How much were you having to change that plan as you went along?
Well, the plan is totally dynamic. What pilots are always taught to do is to evaluate the decisions, and if it's not getting the right result, to change it.
How do you train yourself out of having an emotional response?
Well,
or a fight or flight,
I think the military
response.
And the police and the airlines probably recruit people that tend not to panic. About 10 to 15% of the population, when they're struck with something unusual, will tend not to panic, and they'll do something instinctive out of goodwill for their neighbour or because they've been trained to follow through a drill.
So do you panic about other things?
Pilots tend not to panic.
What would have happened if you hadn't made the decision you made?
If I'd gone on, I have little doubt that I would have died.
John, you headed back down?
There's a hold up. There's no fixed ropes above the South Summit.
Yeah, I know, mate. But we're sorting that situation out now.
Ran out of juice waiting. Cold. I'm sorry, Rob.
That's your call, pal.
I don't want to run out of oxygen up there. Sorry, Rob.
John, that's the movie version of your 1996 Everest expedition. You look like you're going for a walk in the snow in the movie a little bit, don't you, compared to what I know it was like. What actually happened at that moment when you were near the summit of Mount Everest?
That's really, yes, it's a story. It's not not a documentary, so very much Americanized. But at that time, there was no storm. It was just below the South Summit, which my altimeter said just 198 metres short of the summit, but that's still about 3 hours climbing.
Mm-hmm. And what were you doing then? You were turning around and going back.
I decided to turn around at that point and come back down. Mm-hmm.
Just give everybody an idea of what a big decision that was. And I want to have a look at how far you'd climbed here. We've got a graphic here just showing the route that you took. Can you talk us through this? So you went from base camp?
The base camp up to Camp 1, which is about 6,000 metres. It's about 6,500 metres to Camp 2. And Camp 3 is 7,200 metres. Camp 4, the South Col, is about 7,500, and the top is 8,848 metres.
And why, when you were so close to the summit, did you decide to turn around?
It was a decision because I was out of time. I'd been held up the night before getting there because our team was moving slowly. One of the team members, Doug Hansen, was ill, and I didn't know that because we're strung out up the mountain. But we were held up for about an hour and a half, and then another hour and a half at the balcony, where there were a group of not very well-trained climbers climbing a small section. And they held me up for half an hour. And at that stage, I had a chance to look at my watch. And it was 11:30 when I arrived there. It was now midday. And we made a plan to turn around if you couldn't see yourself on the summit by 2 p.m. because that was the plan for various reasons. And at now midday, I could not see myself on the summit before 3 o'clock. And with the slow fellas ahead of me, probably 4 o'clock.
Mm.
And that, I did what's called a military appreciation. I'd spent a lot of time in the army. And very much like Richard was saying, you're trained to do things. And in a military appreciation, or appreciation of any plan where lives are at stake, there are drills that you go through. And there are certain limits which you dare not transgress. And one of those is if you've made a plan, well-considered, logical, calculated plan, you don't change that plan for any emotional reason. Unless something catastrophic happens, you stick to that plan, otherwise things go pear-shaped. Mm. And our plan was to turn around. And the logical part of my decision that day was easy. The emotional part, of course, was the fact that I just spent 6 years and a heck of a lot of money and and did nothing but eat, climb and sleep and work for a number of years before I got there. So I was turning my back on that, which was just 2 hours away, 3 hours away.
Not everyone took that decision, that same decision.
No, unfortunately not. There's in fact, it's got a name. They call it summit fever. When people get to the top, they cast aside logical plans and logical turnaround times because the summit's so close, they've invested so much in it, both physically, financially, psychologically, that they keep on going.
How many people died?
Eight people. Mm. And Rob Hall, who I was shown in that section there, he went on and he died. I turned back.
And he was the expedition leader?
Yes, he was.
So he had been part of that plan as well?
He basically made the plan, yes. Yeah.
Mm. What would have happened if you hadn't made the decision you made?
If I'd gone on, I have little doubt that I would have died. I would have.
Why? Why was it so dangerous to keep going at that time?
There's a storm came where the temperature was 40 below zero and the winds were up to about 180 kilometres an hour. So people got frostbite and died. But what went through my mind at the time was something that we all knew, but in the appreciation you go over the things that you know. By 4 o'clock, if I was on the summit at 4 o'clock, meant I wouldn't be off the mountain back to the safety of Camp 4. By 6 o'clock, it got dark around about 5:30. So I'd be coming down the last parts of the mountain in the dark. The oxygen I had would run out at about 4:30. And at that level, even though you're only getting a little oxygen, it does make a difference. When the oxygen runs out, you really get disoriented. I would have been more fatigued than I was now, and we'd been climbing constantly for many, many hours at that stage. Most people die coming off a mountain. More people die coming down than going up. And also the weather sometimes blows up, even though I had no idea there was a storm coming at that time. It often blows up and makes things a little more tricky. So all of those things went through my mind, and I could see the risks escalating, and the logical decision was to cut. And so I did.
Was it an easy decision in those circumstances?
The logical part of it was easy. The emotional side of it, missing out on the top when I was so close, and I felt well enough to get there. I had little doubt I would get there. To miss out when you knew you could get there, but you realised the logical decision was to go, that was difficult, the emotional side of it.
Mm. How do you think you would have gone in Richard's situation and vice versa? I'm really interested in this because you're both very wedded to this idea of a plan, that you had a plan.
I was listening to Richard and there were just wonderful words. He's talking about two things, talking about panic and logical decisions. And in one of the military units I served in, there was a sign that we always had in our minds, panic kills. And less than panic, you have emotion. You have logical decisions, you have transforming into some emotional input into the decisions, to a lot of emotional input into the decision, to panic. And that's where things go wrong. If you panic, you are paralysed. If you're in a situation like Richard was saying, and you didn't have a drill to go through, that's when panic sets in. But you have all these drills, they're automatic procedures that you go through. It makes it a lot easier than most people think.
Mm. Richard, you made a big decision in the air, though, that veered away from established emergency procedure. And I'm really interested in that, given you know, the importance of the plan and so on. Tell us about the control checks that you decided to do and how they work and why you did them.
Well, before we made our approach, I was very concerned because we had lost 65% of our roll control. And that brought up the question that the checklist did not. Would we be able to control the aircraft when we slowed and configured to land? An aircraft, an LL aircraft in Amsterdam, had crashed in 1992 when they didn't do the control checks. So this is something which every Air Force person is trained to do. If the aircraft gets hit by ground fire or mid-air collision, they basically test fly or do a dress rehearsal of the landing at a safe height to determine or to prove that the aircraft is safe to land.
How do you do that? How do you do a dress rehearsal of a landing in the air?
Well, we actually brought it back to the configuration with the flaps and the landing gear that we would land at the landing speed. But every time we make a change, one change, I would aggressively manoeuvre the aircraft to see if it would depart. Now, if it did depart, then you would know that that last choice was unwise and you would come back and reselect something. You're at a safe height to prove the aircraft in case something goes wrong.
So are you overriding what the system is telling you should do at that point?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah. Yes. It helps no one if you follow every rule and you don't survive.
Was what you did risky?
It is 1/1000th of a risk to do a control check than to make an approach without doing it.
Was it a smooth touchdown?
It surprisingly was.
And in the end, how much time was there between the explosion and when you actually landed the plane?
It was 1 hour and 50 minutes from the explosion to when we landed. And again, that was spent trying to understand the aircraft we had. We were criticised for staying up too long.
John, how long did you have to make your decision about whether you were going to keep going or turn around?
About 30 minutes, and I didn't have 198 or whatever it was people relying on me, just myself.
Mm.
And two others that I talked into coming back with me. Yeah.
So you talked people into coming with you?
Mm. They were... I met them just as I started back down, after telling Rob that I was heading back. And they were coming up in zombie mode, plodding along, and I pulled them up and said, where do you think you're going? And they said, oh, heading for the top. And I said, look at the time. And it didn't take much to convince them that it was better to come down.
And how did Rob react to you turning around?
He was disappointed because he loved to help with logistical supply to get people to the top. But what I thought about a lot later, why didn't I question him? Why did I accept the fact that he went on when I could see full well that he was breaking his own rules? But that's probably the lack of oxygen, the hypoxia at that level.
So was there a sense of guilt about that, or...?
No. Hmm. No, Rob, he could have been going... I know he was going up to look after Doug Hansen, who subsequently died with him. No, Rob was the world's strongest Western climber at that stage. Who would I be to question him on what he was doing, really? No. Hmm.
Shay, yours is a very different story to these...
Very.
tell us what doctors discovered when you were 15 and a half weeks pregnant.
They discovered that I had a very aggressive ovarian cancer. I think they said it went from, at 12 weeks, I can't remember the exact size, I think it was about 11 centimetres, and when it was actually removed, it was around 20 centimetres. They said it was like a volleyball.
What did they suggest you do at the beginning?
Oh, beginning was horrible. They basically came in, dropped this bomb and then said, it's okay, it's early enough that we can terminate the pregnancy. You'll be back in a couple of days to have a full hysterectomy, you know, remove this and that.
Joanne, you're Shay's mum. What did you want her to do?
Well, I wanted her to terminate the pregnancy, and I realised very early on in the diagnosis that our wants were the same. Like, I felt a bit emotional. I wanted to save my baby, and she was wanting to save hers. And I realised I had to step back and let Shay listen to her body and do what she wanted to do. But, yeah, it was difficult.
So what decision did you make at that stage, Shay?
Oh, I was dead. I was, all along, I was having the baby.
No question?
No.
A few days later, after it was clear that you weren't going to go with that option, mm-hmm. you were given three other options. What were they?
One was to do absolutely nothing and hope that I'm one of the very, very rare people who a cancer like this doesn't progress and hasn't spread. Their second one was to do nothing for the short term, be induced so I could have the baby at about between, I think they said 24 to 28 weeks. And then the final one was to do chemotherapy while I was pregnant. The problem was they all had problems. All three options were far from ideal. So.
And what did you decide to do?
I decided to go with the chemo. It was that was the one that the
while you were pregnant.
Yeah, that was the one that the oncologist was recommending. And I mean, the option to do nothing wasn't. I probably would have just done that, but yeah, I just couldn't do it. I realised, oh, it's not just me. I've got a mum and a sister and a husband at the time, and so it was all very. That wasn't going to happen.
So okay, so you weighed that one up. What about the other option of having the baby early?
To birth him at 28 weeks, I was for a while sort of thinking this could work. We had a friend who worked in the NICU. And she said, come in and just see what you're looking at. And I went in and I remember seeing this tiny little 28-week-old baby and it broke my heart. I thought, I can't do that to him. That would be awful. Mm. So I wanted to go with the option with the least risk. So it's why we went with the chemo.
So was that difficult, making that decision?
Huge, yeah.
How long did it take?
I'd say it was probably a week. Yeah, about a week, week and a half before I actually was fully convinced that this is the right thing to do. I mean, the biggest problem for me with that option was, though, that they weren't really sure what the chemo would do. There wasn't a whole heap of there wasn't a lot to say that it was going to be okay or not.
There was a big unknown.
There was. There's nothing to say that there would be any, you know, abnormalities, and I just remember hearing him saying this going, you don't sound very confident. Could you maybe tell me that you're sure? But
was the decision made with your head or with your heart?
It was made with my heart, but other people's heads. I do everything by my heart.
So you're the opposite to these two guys.
Yeah, this is why I'm listening to them going, ooh. Can't say I probably would have not gone with you down the mountain because I would have been like, but I want to. I'm a bit more like that.
I'm also a doctor. and an anaesthetist, so I see a lot of cancer patients. And this would have been an absolutely unique situation. There would have been no rule book for a pregnant woman with ovarian cancer to then continue the pregnancy and have chemotherapy. Really out of the box. So that's why they could give you no guarantees. But obviously, I mean, I'm saying so after the fact, but at the time I would have said the most logical decision was the one that she made. That was with her heart, but also the most logical decision.
What would you have done in that situation if it had been your wife or your daughter?
Oh, boy, that does bring it home. But I know I'd have...
Well, it's interesting because it's taking you out of the zone that you're used to making decisions in, and I just wonder whether you'd have been able to apply those same very logical, you know, application, whether you would have had those very logical applications to that kind of situation or whether emotion would have been a bigger factor.
Jenny, definitely emotion would have been a bigger factor, but no, as Richard says, I think both of us have learned to be able to put emotion to one side when you're making decisions about massive decisions such as this.
Mm. Could you have done that, Richard, do you think?
Well, when you get the unknown unknowns, the black swans, the things that no one's prepared for, then there really is no prepared defence. And the only thing that can really be your guide is your values and beliefs and your emotional core, which is you can't explain in words, but that will drive you and that will determine if you understand what you're really thinking, what you value, that which for me on QF32 was the passengers. So the aircraft was just a screwdriver, didn't matter, just a tool, but the passengers were important. And so, you know, we get to a certain point where you do become, you do trust your emotional core, and that's what you did.
I don't think I could be a pilot. Everything I do is run by emotion, and I tend to...
But you made massive decisions.
Yeah.
You know, they were massive decisions.
Yeah, they were.
Noor, you made a series of very high-stakes decisions which had a huge impact on your life and your community. What did you decide to do?
I came out earlier this year as a gay imam, Australia's first gay imam.
Hmm. Now, you serve a congregation of hundreds of people in Melbourne. How high were the stakes in doing that?
Well, very high. You lose that platform and there's even a risk to your life.
Why is there a risk to your life as a Muslim leader?
The conservative school of thought in Islam to deal with homosexuality, being gay, lesbian, transgender, is to be killed. And that is your repentance to gain entrance into the kingdom of heaven. So the risks were quite high. And I have family as well. And part of the risks was that my family was going to be targeted because of the principle that I stood for.
Mm. Now, you had been married earlier and you told your wife about your sexuality. When had you done that and how big a decision was that for you?
It took... we have a child, my daughter, and I was married for 1 year because I could not do it to an innocent person. I could not bring this girl into my web of lies. As a Muslim leader, or generally as a Muslim, once you reach a certain age, you're expected to get married. And that solves all your problems. And have children. And so, you know, when you have these issues within you as a gay person in an environment that is hostile to even discussing this topic, you have one of two options. Either you give in to the pressure of getting married, which I did, or reject everything, reject your faith, reject your family and move away. And I had a problem with that. I lasted 1 year.
And what happened when you told her?
She felt betrayed. And it took a while for her to recover from that.
And your family found out?
Yes. Correct, yes. Mm.
And how did that play out?
So it was a big shock, and but I decided to take advantage of that story and or that journey that I went through and make something positive out of it. And I try to help other families now cope with how to deal with a family member who's gay, lesbian, transgender, because And it's been successful thus far.
How risky was it for you to decide to be public about this, to speak publicly? You spoke on the feed on SBS.
Correct.
About this. How risky was that for you? What did it mean potentially?
One of my teachers, when I was memorizing the Quran, he used to make us, before we decide any, before we take any step, he would make us think of 1,000 outcomes. And he would always make us sit down and write them down, and he would make us start from worst case scenario. I thought carefully when I decided to, this year in particular, to speak to the media. I started the group that looks after the welfare of LGBT Muslims. Next month, in fact, will be our third anniversary. So when I decided to start this group, I didn't come up with 1,000 outcomes, but I really thought carefully of the consequences.
What was the worst case scenario that you had?
Death, being killed.
That you'd be killed?
Correct.
And how real a fear was that for you? And is it still a fear?
Look, you know, I'm not... there's a famous Arab saying, they say, مَنْ لَمْ يَمُتْ بِالسَّيْفِ مَاتَ بِغَيْرِهِ. If you don't die by a sword or a gun, you will die by something else in a battlefield. Death has many ways, but eventually we all die. But what I had a problem with was not that. That I could sleep with that. But what I could not sleep with, seeing injustice being done repeatedly to young individuals from my community and the wider community by family members, that I could not accept.
Making the original decision was the easy thing. Living with the results of that decision has been the hardest part. I'll never know, but I made the right decision.
You survived the Bali bombings. You helped save lives at the Sari Club, and you received a hero's welcome when you came back to Australia. But that didn't sit well with you. Why not?
When the bomb went off, I was going in and out of the Sari Club. I'd probably been in and out half a dozen times, pulled people out. And as I worked my way deeper into the club, I heard three girls crying, and I looked, and a section of the roof, probably 8-10 metres across, had fallen down. And it was a thatched roof. And they were crawling out and crying for someone to help them. And I had to make the decision. Whether I would do that. And my heart was telling me these girls needed me. And my gut instinct was telling me that was a foolish thing to do because I could never survive it. So I had to turn around and find somebody else to help. Whew. I've only admitted this in the last few weeks. It's very tough. I've taken ownership of the decision to abandon those girls. And I found it very, very, very hard to forgive myself. I thought I had abandoned when these girls needed my help.
But you'd helped so many people. You'd helped other people before this, right? You'd gone
yeah,
in and out of the club.
No, I don't. My life has never been about the things I've done. I tend to live life by the things and experiences I haven't done. And when I got back to Australia and people are calling you a hero, I felt a fraud because there were a number of things I hadn't done. I hadn't saved those three girls. I could only see the things that I hadn't done. And I lived in shame for a long time. As I said, it was only Bali.
So you kept that to yourself? You kept that feeling to yourself?
Yes.
For how long?
Nearly 14 years. I only took ownership of the decision perhaps 3 to 4 weeks ago.
And what prompted that? What prompted you to do that?
Probably at the start of this year, my mum died. I was very close to my mum, and she was always my rock.
And have you talked to anyone about it? Have you sought help to talk?
I've sought help. I had counselling, and the counselling was good. But the one thing that the counselling does, counselling forces you to be honest with yourself.
Does the logical part of your mind recognise that that was probably, you know, the only decision in a way that you could have made? Otherwise, you would have died as well.
I tell myself that every day and every night before I go to sleep. I try to reconcile that. But it's, you know, I'm not sure these guys have all done it as well. You go through the what-if scenarios. What if I'd done this? What if I tried this way? Could I have gone around? Could I have run really fast across the top? Would I have made it? There's all these situations. So, in essence, making the original decision was the easy thing. Living with the results of that decision, for me, the emotional side has been the hardest part.
And do you remember much about the decisions you made at that time in that crisis situation? Because you made numbers of decisions.
Well, not really, because it was a bizarre situation. There was cars burning, people running around on fire, people bleeding. There was blood and guts everywhere. There was a tremendous... There was fertiliser in the air because there was a fertiliser bomb. The heat was intense. I just ran back, started going into the Surrey Club.
And doing what when you were
just
in there?
Just grabbing anybody I could and pulling them out.
So you did help people on that night?
Yeah, I pulled people out.
Yeah, you're almost reluctant to admit that.
I don't look at it in terms of people I helped. I look at it in terms of people that I couldn't help and didn't help.
And why do you think that is?
I think it's just the nature of the way that I am.
And how do you feel about it now when you say that in the last little while, you know, you've decided that you want to talk about it and deal with it? How do you feel about it now?
Look, it's a relief getting it out and not trying to hide it and not feeling a fraud anymore. But it's still a difficult decision to live with it. Three girls were relying on me and I let them down.
It seems like one thing that you could look at is if you had saved them, you might not have been able to save the other people that you did save.
Yeah, it's difficult though, because they were there and that was them.
Has it made it easier or harder for you to do what you've done in the last little while in relation to this?
I guess Bali gave me a purpose to try and help people out there, because, you know, six Australian men a day commit suicide. And having been so close to that myself, I feel a kinship with those guys. And I think that, yes, I've got to put myself out there and talk about depression and talk about counselling and dealing with it and coping with it.
Eric, I had a lot of post-traumatic stress after my incident, and it occupied all my sleep, all my daytime, all my time with the family, which meant that I didn't, because I was reliving the incident. 24 hours a day, I would wake up exhausted. And doing the what-ifs, and I was dysfunctional. And I identified that, and I went away from left flying for 4 months. And the emotions that you have are deep in your mind. They're emotional. You can't put words to them, but when you discuss it, it makes you cry. And I cried when I revisited it. But when you talk about it the way you are, and women are good at this, they put their emotions on their sleeves and they talk through it, it actually brings it into context in your whole mind. It puts it into a balance and you realise that none of this was your fault. You were given a bad pack of cards and you saved lives. You did a whole lot of good. You can't be responsible for everyone.
I think what we're seeing here tonight, just looking at it, instinct is a word that keeps coming up again and again and again. You've got trained instinct over here, you've got heartfelt instinct over here, you've got what I did, which I thought was basically, you know, animalistic instinct, fight and then flight and run. You listen to your instinct. And I think that tells you everyone here has listened to their instinct at some stage, and we're here to tell the story and it's come out okay. And my reckoning from just that says to me that your instinct not to go in there after pulling all those other people out was the right thing to do.
What are you all like at making decisions in the rest of your lives? You
not
know,
great.
Not in an emergency, not in the middle of a crisis.
I could never be something that required you to use your brain before your heart, because I would go heart first, 99.9% of the time. So I'm lucky I've got people around me who go, but you sure?
What about the rest of you?
I dislike restaurant menus. I dislike doing trivial decisions. So Obama, I think, wears the same suit every day. He doesn't want to waste the decision on deciding what to wear. And I just order the fish off the menu. But if there's a good challenge, then I enjoy a good challenge of a difficult decision. And I'll say, well, let's invert the logic and think of what you would never imagine doing. And so I'm not afraid of decisions. I just don't want to spend all day
just
doing
that. Just don't like them very much. What about you, John? What do you like at decisions?
I have to admit, with large decisions, I have no problems at all because you can go through a logical process. But little decisions like cleaning up or throwing stuff away, I agonise.
You're a hoarder.
My wife will be listening to this. So I find very difficult.
See, I find that so fascinating. So you're an agoniser in other parts of your
Many
life.
Many times I go through and I'm about to throw. Bow, perhaps. Mm.
Shay, you had your chemotherapy.
Yes.
And you had your baby.
Yes.
At 38 weeks.
I did.
How old is Spencer now?
Spencer's 7. He turned 7 in September.
And you then made another really big decision. There's that heart again. You then made another really big decision to have another baby.
Yes.
A daughter.
Yeah.
Called Harper.
I had a little girl called Harper.
Mm. Wow. And that was risky for different reasons.
Yes. So basically after Spencer was born, my oncologist said, right, the best thing that's going to prevent and you know, keep you alive and prevent cancer coming back is going to be you having a full hysterectomy. And straight away I was like, really? Again, I was a bit stubborn about it. I said, no, I'm having two. And I refused to let cancer make that decision for me.
So you're really putting yourself at risk again at this point to have a second child, to not have that hysterectomy to guard against the cancer.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
And how are you and the kids now?
Yeah, we're good. We're really good. They're fun. They're gorgeous.
And Dan, would you do anything differently, do you think, faced with that armed hold-up that you had?
If the circumstances varied, if it was exactly the same, then, yeah, of course I'm going to fight to try and get myself out of that situation like I did.
And Noor, what about you? If you had your time over, would you do anything differently?
Not at all. Not at all.
And Eric, hearing the encouragement you've had from the people in this room about your decision?
I guess I've gone comfort with my decision. My gut instinct has always told me it was the right decision to make. I've just got to live with the emotional side of it.
Well, thank you so much for joining us and for sharing your story tonight, all your stories tonight. We really appreciate it. It's been really very interesting. Thank you very much. And that is all we have time for here, but let's keep talking on Twitter and on Facebook. We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks very much, everybody. Thank you.
Why are you in jail this time?
For assaulting a girl with a cricket bat. I picked it up and hit her 3 times in the head with it.
In the head?
Yep.
Jenny Brockie and Insight were given extraordinary access into a women's maximum security prison.
You could have killed her. I know. I didn't feel anything because of who she is.
Over a number of months, we talked to inmates and officers. We learned about life on the inside, how their lives were on the outside, and the crimes that led them to prison.
Drugs. Opium.
175 kilograms of opium altogether?
Yes.
How many times have you been to jail?
1, 2, 3 or 4.
I've been in every year. For, you know, long periods, short periods of time mainly, for the last 16 years.
Trusting people too much. That's why you think you're in jail? Had you been told what jail was like by people you knew?
Yes. Yeah.
Had many people you'd known been to jail?
Most of my family. I've been in a fight in jail. I broke her nose, I split her bottom lip and broke her 2 fingers.
Am I going to see you back?
I hope you never see me again here.
Mm-hmm. How much money do you reckon I'd have if I had 10 cents for every time I heard I'm never coming back?
Oh, I wouldn't put money on it, so I can't promise you.
You deliberately breached your parole?
Yeah, I deliberately.
To get back into jail?
Yeah.
A male inmate, he'll ask you the same question over and over and over. And when you answer the question for the 10th time, you might say to him, listen, mate, the answer's no, and it's because, and you'll give him the reasons why the answer is no. And he'll say, oh, okay, miss, all right, fair enough. And he'll leave it at that. But a lot of the female inmates can't take no for an answer. So it's just constant, but why, but why, but why? They don't have a stop button.
You have a young teenage son.
Yes.
Does he visit you in jail?
Yes, he does.
What do you think it's like for him?
I would say it's not very good for him.
You were pregnant and you went into labour in custody. So how long did you have with her?
Probably 2 hours.
Do you think prison works in the sense that it might change people for the better?
No.
I know it's not right to take other people's stuff, but I also don't have any remorse for it, if that's what you're asking.
So you don't regret doing it?
No, not at all.
A two-part insight special. 8:30 Tuesday, November 8th and 15th on SBS.